Hey guys, in this week's tips and tricks video, we're going to be jumping back into some basics and discuss some workflow observations inside of Maya regarding its handling of object history and how certain tools that are used on an object can impact the outcome depending on, let's say, what order they're used in and how you may want to edit them once you've already begun using different tools on that same object. So to further explain, let's have a look at a few simple examples. So to start, I'm just going to go ahead and create a simple cube. Let me just hit F to frame in on here. 5 to go into shading mode. And then under the inputs, I'm just going to go in here and change the subdivision height, width, and depth to 3 each. Now, let's say we wanted to go and edit this. Now, we could always go into vertex mode and begin moving this around, but it's not exactly going to impact the history in the way that we want to kind of express in this lesson. So in order to start modifying this shape, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a lattice deformer to it. So you can go up to the animation, go to create deformers, lattice option box, and then I'm just going to go ahead and keep these settings. So I'm going to click close after I hit apply. And once I hit F8, I can go into the object mode. And it's obviously a real tight fit on this box, but as we'll see in a second here, it's actually not quite moving it as we thought. As we see, it's kind of breaking the bounds of it as I stretch it beyond the limits of its normal, basically, deformation that it's allowed given the number of faces and edges I put in here. So I'm just going to go in here and kind of edit some of these real quick. Just move them out of place, maybe scale some of them. Okay, now let's say from here we wanted to go in and add maybe a smooth modifier, or let's say the smooth tool, to go ahead and smooth the surface of it a bit. Now if we look down here into the inputs, we're going to begin to see what's a list of all of the things that we're doing to modify the original polycube shape that's at the bottom of the list here. So we have our initial tweak where I kind of, for a second, let's say, showed how we can move the vertices to modify the object. Then we have this FFD box here, which is basically this freeform deformation box. And then we have our polysmooth face, which actually has all of these options in it right here. So I'm going to go ahead and maybe crank the divisions up to 2. And from here, let's say I want to begin editing some more on this box. Now, because of how these two work together, it's like you're not going to encounter too many problems to where, let's say, if I want to go back in this list and edit the freeform deformation box that I added to it before adding the smooth face, that's actually going to be okay. So next, let's say I wanted to add a bend modifier or a bend tool to this mesh right here. So I'm going to go up to create deformers, nonlinear, bend, and I'd say for here we can just click apply. That should be fine. And again, I'm just going to scrub down here, and I'm just going to go ahead and begin to edit some of these. Change the curvature to, let's say to 0.5, and then maybe move this. Just kind of rotate it into place. And maybe just quickly adjust the bounds of it. Now, we have this actual bend tool itself selected, so that's why we're only seeing the options for this here, since it's a separate tool. Now if we were to go in here and select the actual mesh, we'll also see it here because that's what's being applied to this mesh and where all these tools are as well. But if we only have that tool itself selected, we're not going to see any additional, let's say, tools in the history like the smooth and the lattice. Let's see if we can just go in here and begin to adjust maybe the high bounds and the low bound a bit. And again, this is just a quick example just to kind of show you how these objects are working in Maya's history together to create this object that we have here. So from here, let's say I want to go back and just begin to modify some more lattice points here. We'll just see that still, this is all fine. This is all working together nice and well. But as we'll see in our next example, we're going to get into some issues where they may not work so well together. This essentially right here is just basically a quick example of how some of these tools do work together, and how you can kind of begin to move back and forth between them to kind of work freeformly and not have to worry about the order that you're going in, even though in the future you're probably going to want to, as we'll see in the further example. So from here, let's say that we like the shape that this object is and we want to go ahead and save it. One thing that we can do inside Maya is delete all the history, and that's just going to go ahead and take this geometry object that you have here and remove everything from it, basically all the tools that are used to create it. So we can do that by going up to Edit, Delete by Type, History, and what we'll see is, well, now we just have our basic cube shape, we don't have any more inputs, and then we have just everything that we have here, all the tools that we use, the final output of everything that we use to create this final shape here. So in the next example, I'm going to go ahead and show you kind of some of the disadvantages to the history inside Maya and why you need to be careful when you decide to use certain tools and exactly when you're going to basically attempt to re-edit the tools over here in the inputs and when you're just going to try and wipe the history clean or add a new tool to the mesh in order to modify it. So I'm going to go ahead and delete this. And let's say, just for the sake of simplicity, I'm just going to create a plane. Just going to scale it up a bit. And let's go in here and just select like a handful of faces in various sections on here on the mesh. Yeah, let's say this should be fine. So let's say we're going to go in here and extrude the mesh. And I'm just going to extrude it up a bit. And then over here in the inputs, I'm going to change the divisions to, let's say, 3. So let's say we're happy with this, and we want to begin to extrude some more faces off these faces right here on these objects. So let's say I'm going to go ahead here and let's say extrude these, and maybe these ones down here, or maybe we'll go up a level. So I'm going to go ahead and add another extrude. I'm going to go ahead and extrude this. And let's say as I go in here and I want to continue modeling, doing various things, let's say select these faces and drop them down, or maybe grab these faces here and drop them down. Now let's say I go back and I decide that I want more divisions to run up this initial set of extrusions, or this initial set of extrusions. Well, if I try and go back down to that first extrude face command inside of the history here, and let's say I want to have 4 divisions, what we'll see is if I type 4 in here and press enter, it's going to completely mess with all the other extrusions that we had on this surface. And that's because you're trying to basically readjust the mesh and the idea, or the identity of some of these, let's say, vertex numbers, after you've already begun to create and use different tools on the mesh. So as you see, as I scrub through adding more divisions, it's pretty much just going to randomly add where it puts this new extrusion from the second extrude face tool up here. Now what you can do is, let's say you have a tool that you used where you actually want to remove the effects of that tool, but you've already used some other tools since you used that initial tool. So let's say, for example, let's say I wanted to remove the extrude face 1. Well, what we're going to see is if we go to the attribute editor and we've got all these tabs up here. If we go to the poly extrude face 1 tab, down towards the bottom, you'll see we have this node behavior rollout. Now, if we go to has no effect, what that's going to do is turn off whatever settings or whatever way the mesh was changed with the use of that tool. Now, with this, what we're obviously going to see is it's going to be basically messed up and almost brought back to its original state. And that's because we did another tool, or we used another extrude tool based off some faces that were created with this initial extrude tool. So that's why when we go here, it's going to make everything disappear. That should be pretty obvious. But what we'll also see is it's also beginning to edit the mesh in areas that we didn't touch. So as you see, we've got, let's say, these 4 faces here that are sunk down below. And when I go to has no effect, it's going to kind of take them away and adjust your surface in other ways. So that's also kind of something to kind of keep in mind when you're going to start editing some of these tools, or possibly, you know, reducing or eliminating whatever settings they have. Now let's say if we went in here and we wanted to extrude some faces here and maybe add some divisions. Now if this is a tool that we wanted to remove, it's a pretty safe bet that we're going to be okay with just removing this, because it's the top of the stack and we have nothing else really around it that's connecting to it. So if we go over to poly extrude face 3 and then just say has no effect, we're going to see that that one actually goes away with no issues. And there's a good chance that you're actually going to be able to do that as well, as long as the, let's say in this case, faces that you're going to be editing with that tool had an effect on aren't impacting any other faces that were connected to it that another tool had used. So for this example, I can actually go in the stack and I'll be able to change face 2 or extrude face tool and not change extrude face 3, because none of the faces that I extruded in Extrude Face 2 were actually near or being impacted by the faces in the tool that we use for Extrude Face 3. So if I go back here and say it has no effect, you'll see that that actually removes those faces but doesn't impact the faces from the other tools. So just keep that in mind if you're going to be kind of working with these tools and let's say how the history works in relationship to tools that are throughout the stack. So when you're actually going to be editing and modeling, a good practice is to kind of get to a certain point where you're happy, and rather than go ahead and begin to try and go back and edit these tools to do some of the stuff that I've taught you here, it's okay sometimes to do that if you know exactly how it's going to work. But as I showed you in the first example, it's usually a pretty safe bet to get to a point to where you want to be and either add more tools or begin to just, let's say, delete the history and almost start from scratch as if that was the initial model you created. So in this case, let's say I turn this tool back on for the second extrude face, but I did want to have more divisions. Let's say another division on the blocks at the top. Well, from here, I could go and let's say delete my history by going to delete all by type, history, and you'll see I have nothing down at the bottom in the inputs in my channel box over here. But from here, what I could do is I could use a separate tool to begin adding more divisions, like this split selected edge rings tool. I can just go in here and begin to add these around here. So again, you don't have to 100% rely on the one initial tool to get you the results that you want. You can kind of begin to use other tools in its place. So just keep that in mind as you're modeling. And again, have an understanding of how all of this is going to kind of work together in the input or history stack right here. Okay, well that concludes this week's weekly tips and tricks video. Thanks again for checking out 3dmotive.com.